Welcome to the next session on commodity derivatives and risk management. And today we will start the commodity price risk associated with agricultural commodities. Now, before we go into understanding how farmers, commodity producers, agri-commodity producers and agri-commodity consumers and all value chain partners like wholesaler, traders, etc., how they can use commodity derivatives market to mitigate their risk. It is very important to understand what fundamental factors influence a agri commodity price. Only when these agri commodity producers or consumers and the value chain partners understand the fundamental factors which affect the commodity prices, then only they will be able to make a view or decision regarding whether price is going to go up or price is going to go down, and accordingly they will be able to take the commodity hedging decision. One of the very important understanding with respect to agri commodity is that we must understand what is a crop year and what is, you know, kharif and rabi farming seasons in India. So let's go to our discussion on Indian agricultural farming season. Indian agricultural farming season can be categorized into two broad categories, that is your kharif season and rabi season. And kharif season starts with the onset of monsoon, that is from June, July, and it goes up to October, November. So many agri commodities are predominantly farmed or produced during this period of time. And which are these commodities? These commodities are rice, maize, groundnut, soybean, sugarcane, arhar, etc. And these agri commodities are start getting the sowing season or planting season starts around June, July or August, and harvest coincides during October, November months. Now the second season is the rabi season. Rabi season, all of you know the meaning of rabi is sun. So those agri produce which require abundant amount of sun ray, these kind of agri commodities are produced or farmed during this period of time. So this rabi season starts during October month and ends during month of March. And which are the predominant commodity which are farmed during this period of time? Wheat, barley, chana, moong dal, urad dal, mustard, and are major agri produce which are produced during this period of time. And harvest season for these rabi commodities coincides with during April to May. In fact, if you recall, many states celebrate their harvest festivals during month of April and May, coinciding with the post harvest or completion of post harvest activities of rabi season commodities. Now also another important aspect which all of us we must understand is a concept called a crop year. All of us we know what is a financial year. It starts from let's say financial year 2014 to 15 starts from 1st April 2014 to March 31st 2015. Similarly, for a crop year for a particular crop starts with the plantation or sowing period, plantation activity, and it goes up to or completes during the harvest period. And it varies from crop to crop, And for example, wheat crop year starts from maybe July, which crop year is from July 1 to June 30, and soybean crop year is starts from September 1 to August 31. So that is 1 year period, September 1st to 31st August is the soybean period. One thing I would like to mention here is wheat crop July 1 to June 30, even if wheat is predominantly treated as a rabi crop, but because of the agricultural advances, now many states are having planting wheat twice a year. So that's the reason why wheat crop year always coincides with July 1 to June 30th. Now, why are we talking about kharif, rabi, or a crop year? Because understanding of this time period is of paramount importance for getting an idea about what is going to be the, what is the pre-harvest period for a pre-plantation period and post-harvest period for a particular agri commodity, because we know most of the agri commodities are seasonal in nature, and pre-plantation period commodity prices, agri commodity prices tend to go up more. And post harvest period agri commodity prices tend to go down. So this is the time period where the commodity prices tend to exhibit greater degree of volatility, and this is the time period where commodity producers, consumers and value chain partners are more keen on entering into price risk management aspects. Now, continuing with our discussion on crop year, the crop year is also another very important aspect which we must understand for a given given agri commodity, because the quality of agri commodity which is produced in one crop year varies from the another crop year depending upon the weather condition. And depending upon pest, the infliction of pests, and various other parameters which can have impact on the quality of the agri commodity produced during one crop year vis-a-vis another crop year. In fact, if you recall in the session third or fourth when we were discussing about the commodity contract specification, exchanges very very clearly mention which crop year can be delivered. If you recall, in the cotton contract specification, the multi commodity exchange had very categorically the contract specification indicated that only the cotton which has been produced in the current crop year can be delivered as part of the futures contract. So understanding what is a farming season, that is rabi and kharif, as well as what is the crop year associated with a particular commodity, is of extreme importance to a person who is interested to enter into any kind of hedging or enter into futures or options on agri commodities. Now let's go to understanding of what has been the traditional price risk management for agricultural produce. You know that MCX, NCDEX, etc. came into picture only from 2003-2004 onwards. So prior to that, how agri commodity producer or farmer was mitigating the price risk? Was there any avenue for them, or they were left to the mercy of fluctuation of the fluctuation of market prices, and some year they will be having windfall gain and some year they will be incurring substantial amount of losses? Yes, they did not, Indian farmers and producers, agri producers did not have access to futures trading, but there were some other mechanism which were available to Indian farmers for mitigating the price risk. And what are these traditional price risk management avenues for Indian farmers. These are crop insurance, contract farming, and minimum support price mechanism of Government of India. All of you must have heard something called MSP. So MSP stands for minimum support price mechanism of Government of India. So now next 5 to 10 minutes, let's understand different aspect of what is a crop insurance, what is contract farming, and what is minimum support price mechanism of Government of India, and how these three mechanism were used by Indian farmers to mitigate the price risk. And all of you must be knowing, or most of you may be having, or your family members may be having different kind of insurance, life insurance, health insurance, and medical insurance. So or even travel insurance. So many we take insurance, we pay premium, and in case of any untoward activity happens, the insurance company pays us the sum insured. Similarly, Indian farmers have been taking crop insurance for considerable number of years. Let's go to little more understanding, little more on crop insurance. The crop insurance has been a very, very long history of India, in India. And general insurance company, I'm sure most of you have heard, a company called GIC was set up in the year 1972 with the exclusive objective of providing farm insurance to farmers. And at different point of time, General Insurance Company and other insurance companies in India have offered different kinds of crop insurance. So two of the important one is the comprehensive crop insurance scheme, and the second one is the farm income insurance scheme. And in the year 2000, also National Agricultural Insurance Scheme came into. It was also known as Rashtriya Krishi Bima Yojana. I am not going into the detail of these, each of these insurance schemes. However, the bigger picture, what I want all of you to appreciate, is that the crop insurance has been one way of mitigating price risk by farmers. In fact, recently, Mr. Narendra Modi has initiated during his tenure, Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. This has been launched during January 2016, and it covers a wide gamut of agricultural produce from different kind of cereals, millets and pulses, oil seeds, and different kind of horticultural crops. Like pomegranate and grapes, etc. So this Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana is a very comprehensive insurance plan, and this Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, it covers the all risk a farmer faces during sowing or planting period, to the risks faced by standing crop, that is during the sowing to harvesting period. So when the standing crop is in the field, if there is any natural calamity, drought, dry spell, flood, etc., and this insurance is going to cover. It also covers the post harvest losses, that and it is a the period of post harvest losses is only 2 weeks. And if you, I mean, you know why it is 2 weeks, because many a times farmers leave after cutting the harvest, they leave the harvest in the open field for drying. So if any natural calamity happens during that period of time, this comprehensive insurance plan is supposed to take care of it. And also certain localized calamities, maybe at a, some calamity happened at a very, very small place also, that is covered in during this Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. So this has been one of the crop insurance has been one of the interesting one of the traditional avenues of price risk management for Indian farmers. Here, on a lighter note, I would like to share some, interesting, insurance behavior by people who take insurance. If you see, I'm not sure whether you are able to see the screen. If you see the natural fire, I have, color coded with blue, giving a little bit of importance. My question to all of you: can there be a man-made fire? Yes, there can be a man-made fire. Many a times, the party which has taken an insurance have, started the fire on their own for insurance claim. So, in this context, I'd like to share a joke with all of you. That joke is, two men met at a beach, and they started talking. And one person, the first man, asked the second man, "What brought you? Why have you come to this beach?" So the first man answers that there was a major flood in my locality. I was in office, and in that flood, all my family member got swept away. However, because I was in office, I was saved, and the insurance company gave me substantial amount of money. I have lot of money, but I don't have anybody to share this money, and I'm very sad. But what to do? I have come to this sea beach to spend some time, and I have money, but I don't have anybody to share this, and I'm being lonely. Then this person, who says that his family member got swept away, and then he asked the other person, what made you come here alone to this beach without family member? The second person says, yes, exactly, our fate seems to be very similar. I was away, and there was a major fire in my house, and all my family members perished, and however insurance company gave me a lot of money, and I have come here alone to spend some time. Then after a pause, the second person asks the first person, "Can you please tell me, how did you cause the flood?" I hope you have got the gist of the joke. And so what basically I am driving at is that many a times because of various reason, the insurance company may underpay or may delay in paying to the farmers what they deserve or what the amount of loss they have incurred. So though insurance has been can be treated as a price risk mitigation mechanism, but it is not enough to cover all risks suffered by a farmer. Now let's go to another second avenue, traditional risk management avenue, which Indian farmers have used. Let's go to the second one, that's called your contract farming. In case of a contract farming, the farmer or producers enter into a forward contract with a buyer, normally a company. So farmer or producer or cooperative society, if they are producing, let's say, potato or wheat, or it could be any agri commodity or tomato, they enter into a forward contract where this farmer or producer group fix the price beforehand, and the company, who is the counterparty, buys the produce at a fixed price at a later point of time. And does contract farming quite prevalent? Yes, to a certain extent, contract farming is quite prevalent in Indian context. So this is this hyperlink. Just give me a minute, please. So this is the list of companies please, I hope you are able to see the screen properly. So these are the private sector Indian companies which have entered into contract farming in India. This particular detail I have downloaded from Government of India website, agmarketnet.nic.in. So if you see, these are the almost 25 companies which have entered into contract farming with for different kind of commodities. So you have cotton, you have marigold, and okay, there's a comma, marigold comma chili. So you have wheat, maize, soybean, Escorts India buys basmati rice from Punjab. Then there is a company called Global Green Company which buys gherkin, baby corn and paprika. So you have Safola, then you have milk. Nestle India has entered into contract farming with Punjab for milk. So you tomato, chili, and you know the list can very widely you know, many different kind of agri commodities has been entered into the contract. Farmers have entered into contract farming, and all of you or many of you may have heard about PepsiCo India entering into contract farming for its potato requirement for one of its popular brands of potato chips. I'm sure most of you must be enjoying a packet of potato chips available on the in the roadside. So it is one of the largest selling consumer snacks in India, but the 10 rupee or 5 rupee potato chips packet. So PepsiCo is the first Indian company which has entered into collaborative farming for potatoes, and this contract farming it has entered into with farmers from Bengal, Maharashtra, Punjab, Gujarat, UP, Karnataka, Bihar, Haryana and Chhattisgarh. And please see this first bulleted point. As part of the contract farming, assured buyback of produce at a pre-agreed price which insulates farmers from open market price fluctuation. So whenever a farmer or farmers cooperative enters into a contract farming agreement, they are assured of the price at which they will be selling potato, and also they are assured of the quantity of take. So not only the farmers enter into price and fixation, they also enter into a quantity, how much quantity they will be delivering to PepsiCo. In the academia, public domain, there has been lot of discussion has happened whether contract farming is harming the farming community or not. That's not the agenda today. What we are discussing is that if a farmer decides to go for a contract farming, that farmer is not exposed to the price risk. He is able to take care of the risk associated with the price which he would otherwise have got if without the contract farming. Now all of you must have heard about the minimum support price program of Government of India. In fact, it is nothing but a contract farming by government of by a government. In the contract farming, what we discussed just now, the private companies are the counterparty with the farmers, and here in case of a minimum support price, the government is the counterparty. So minimum support price is the price at which government purchases crops from the farmers to safeguard the interest of the farmers. And before the before a crop year, this minimum support price is announced by the Government of India so that the farmers get to know what is the minimum support price they are going to get, and accordingly they will start taking the farming decisions. So MSP is announced by Government of India, and there is a body called CACP, Commission of Agricultural Cost and Prices. So this CACP gives or announces what is going to be the price at which Government of India is going to buy some of the agricultural commodities. So let me just show you. Let me increase the size. If you see, this is the this is the announcement which was done on 15 February 2015, and which are the commodity which are covered by the CACP. You have a paddy, you have jowar, you have bajra, you have ragi, maize, toor, moong, urad, groundnut, safola, soybean, and wheat, barley, gram, lentil, all this, and jute, sugarcane, copra, copra ball, all these are mentioned. And this particular PDF file, again I have downloaded from government CACP website. If you see, which is the which different year, 2007, 2008, 2009, so on and so forth, what has been the during 2015 only, Government of India has announced how much is going to be the minimum support price for these commodities, which is going to be produced during 2015-16 and 2016-17. So this is and how CACP decides what price it is going to pay. Takes into consideration quite a lot of factors. Some of the important factors which it takes into consideration is the cost of production. So if the seed cost, if the fertilizer cost and all that has gone up, so it takes into cost of production. It also takes into consideration the market price in previous year, and also ensures that the intercrop price parity. So whatever last year price they had, it had paid, it also tries to maintain some kind of a parity with the last crop year production. So with this, we come to an end of our discussion on what has been the traditional price risk management avenue for Indian farmers. So it has been the crop insurance, and it is contract farming. And the third is the minimum support price program of Government of India. So with this, we will be ending this session. We'll be continuing with the remaining part of agricultural price risk management in the next session. Looking forward to meeting you all, and thank you.